Welcome to the Urban Pitch Podcast, the beautiful game of life. Today we have Daniel Gamba. He is the GM of SoCal Sports Club. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Pleasure being here.
Great. Can you describe to the audience your club, when you guys started, and kind of what it's about?
Yeah, of course. We started basically about a year and a half ago. We started together with the facility manager of the San Bernardino Soccer Complex. So we had access to the facility. We were just trying to find ways on how could we leverage the facility more proactive. Mm-hmm. You know, so we decided to put together a team and eventually showcase the local talent, mm-hmm. provide an opportunity, a platform for the local players to showcase their skills, eventually with the players that are aiming to play for professionally, right, in a higher level. You know, we got, I would say, a little bit unfortunate. We launched the club the same day that a tragedy, mm-hmm. hit the community.
Right. The shooting,
yeah. So we kind of took a little bit of a couple steps back, mm-hmm. and we want to be respectful to the community. We didn't want to be perceived as that we were taking advantage of promoting ourselves on top of a tragedy. Mm-hmm. So that hurt us a little bit, mm-hmm. but we still were very successful the first year. I can say that, you know, off the field, we've done extremely well providing a platform for kids to keep themselves busy and playing professional, right, soccer. And we did extremely well on the season as, okay, well. So,
and you guys play in NPSL, which is the fourth tier of American soccer, right?
Yes, that's correct.
What do you think about the American soccer pyramid right now? You know, a lot of changes, right?
Yeah, a lot of changes.
Yeah. Yeah. And as a GM of a, you know, You consider, so when you meet people and you talk to them, do you call it amateur? You call it semi-pro? How do you refer to NPSL?
I personally refer it as a semi-pro, okay, because I think the NPSL differs itself from other leagues at the same level because, mm-hmm. they provide us the ability to sign professional contracts, okay, with these players. So some teams might choose not to, which is fine. You know, you can have a professional entity playing against amateurs. But I believe in the model of owning the player rights, mm-hmm. and I think that's what you're lacking a little bit of in U.S. soccer. Mm-hmm. You're lacking of more teams finding ways to own this player's rights, okay, and eventually capitalize on that.
I think the U.S., like, American audience doesn't like that terminology probably, right? But then you're Brazilian, you have a Brazilian background, and that's, right, just kind of like common, not only in South America and Europe, right? Kind of like owning the player contract and their rights, right?
Right. Yeah. I think you have a strong team, okay, which we call the top team, and, mm-hmm. Anything that you leverage out of the sales, perhaps, mm-hmm. of the assets that you have on the top team, mm-hmm. helps fund the youth model.
Okay.
You know, and it's very different than America, I understand, right, that. But if we felt that America was doing things the way it should be, mm-hmm. we wouldn't be doing anything different. So, mm-hmm. we want to not try to reinvent the wheel, but just, yeah, to apply some of the ideas that's being used abroad into American soccer, because we believe there's a huge potential here.
Okay. So you're the GM and also co-owner of the team.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What do you think motivates most of the other NPSL owners? Like, you know, I'm sure there's a variety of different reasons and motivations, but do you think most of them are investors at heart? Are they just fans and they're willing to break even or, you know, potentially lose money? What causes an NPSL owner to create a fourth division team in the U.S.?
It's an interesting, very interesting question. I think there are different kind of demographics there. There is the guy that's retired, mm-hmm. and he has a huge passion, mm-hmm. about soccer. And he feels like he can.
And usually those guys are foreign born, right?
Most likely.
Right? They didn't grow up in the U.S., right? No. Some businessman from Europe or something?
Or they grew up in the U.S., okay, you know, and they have enough money that they want to bring a little bit of what they leave when they were little, mm-hmm. into and give it back. Okay. So they have a few guys that think that way. We know of a few particularly.
Okay. So it's like a passionate owner that's kind of like a hobby and he's, right, retired. Okay. Mm-hmm. So there's that kind
there's
of profile.
That. There's the guy that probably has a kid,
okay,
a son or somebody,
okay,
that's growing up in soccer, and, mm-hmm. they feels like they need to have a little bit of a platform, okay, for their kid to, right, showcase their skills.
Okay.
You know, there's, right, also that. The parent. Okay.
the indulgent owner. Parent that also happens to have money to be able to allow his son to follow his dream. Okay, yeah. There's that owner.
There's
okay.
that owner, that too. There are teams now, you know, youth academies that, you know, realize it that they need to provide a little bit of an exit route for their kids.
So it's like an investment vehicle, right? Mm-hmm. You can only do club soccer for so long, but if there's no target above them, right, it's kind of like, right, there's nothing for them to go for as
So you play youth soccer and from 6 to 18, and after 18, I'll tap in you back and say, thank you very much. You've been great partner here, and now the club, now there's nothing else I can do for you.
Right.
I cannot offer you anything. Okay. I don't have a pro team. I might be able to offer you a showcase with the college where a coach can come and see you, but there's nothing there. So there's some youth teams that are perceiving that.
All right. Where do you fall under then? What profile are you and your partner?
I think I'm a little bit of a mix. You know, I personally have a son, obviously, but I'm not doing this for my son.
How old is your son?
Eight years old, yeah. I think I am doing for him, but also for his generation as a whole. I think... kids need to have a better platform to showcase their skills. I feel like I don't want them to fall into this model where I don't want soccer to be perceived as a very expensive babysitting, you know, where what are you getting out of youth soccer right now? It's like you pay to play, right? And parents are, you know, investing on their kids, but between, you know, if you read it between the lines, maybe you can say that they're just paying for somebody to watch their kids for 2-3 hours because what are you getting out of that? You know, I mean, you have that extremely good soccer player that can eventually become a pro. You have a good player that can eventually go to college. What do you do with the guys that don't make it?
So what, so what do you do with those guys then?
Well, if you have a platform where you have an exit route, and then you have a top team where you can provide them an MLS or an abroad opportunity. And if they're not ready to go to that level, they can play at a USL or a minor league level. Or you can convert that guy into a passionate, you know, soccer enthusiast. And then they're eventually going to be a consumer. Eventually they're going to say soccer has given me to me so much, and I'm going to give it back to soccer. I'm going to work with soccer. I am... going to make my kids soccer passionate because soccer gave me so much. You know, you have to have something more off the field. You know, I think right now it's not enough there.
Kind of going with what you're saying and giving multiple options, right? What do you think about, because U.S. soccer is really different from the rest of the world, right? In a lot of different aspects, right? What do you think about promotion and relegation in the U.S.? I know it's a huge topic. It's a hot topic, but what do you think?
I think it's essential. Part of the idea why we invested in the NPSL is it was an, I guess, I don't want to say cheap, but it was a more affordable option for you to own a club. I think the money should be invested in the players. Development, right?
So when you say cheap, how much are we talking? Because, you know, I've read online, you know, like, the varying amounts like per year, but like how much does you have to really have up front in order to have an NPSL team?
I mean, the franchise is not expensive. I mean, depends how you look at it, things, but it's comparing to other leagues, I think $15,000, which is what it cost. It's not a lot of money. And then to run the team on a yearly basis, I think there's people running the team as low as $25,000. And there's very good teams out there running as $250,000-$300,000. So it's a huge gap.
But let's say, for example, like me and a couple buddies, right? We're able to scratch $15,000 together and then another, you know, $50,000 on top of that. Are we going to be able to just pop into NPSL and create a team?
You should. Should be able to. It's not a very expensive. I think there are owners right there that have been very open and publish their numbers. I think the owner of Stockade FC, Dan's, was one of the founders of Foursquare. I think he's even wrote it about it, you know, in kind of like motivating people to, hey, it's actually doable. You know, you don't need that much money. The thing is, you might have enough money to do it for 1 year. Well, what is the sustainable model on the long term? Like you either got to find a way to have fans that's going to pay your bills, or you have to have a good strategy to sell your players eventually, that to help you fund your club.
Right.
Otherwise, you're going to be keep opening and closing clubs, as right. which is kind of the tendency right yeah, nowadays.
Right. And we don't want that, right? We don't want this you know, opening and closing all the time, huh?
No.
Okay.
That's so why I think promotion and relegation is essential. You know, I want every single club that we compete against to succeed. Mm-hmm. You know, I honestly want them to do well. I honestly want them to beat us, because that's going to incentivate mm-hmm. and motivate me to beat them. Mm-hmm. You know, it's actually going to be, you know, my fuel to get better and do better and spend more and invest right. more. You know, so I think promotion and relegation is essential. Maybe MLS doesn't participate. MLS is this okay. exclusive entity.
Okay.
But I think they should open up, you know, all these...
For the lower divisions?
For the lower divisions, yeah. at least. And there are lower divisions already doing that. I believe yeah. UPSL.
They just started
Yeah, they just started, yeah. which is great. All this is really good. You know, okay. hopefully we can roll that idea in into other leagues yeah. in this yeah. country.
Okay, that makes sense. Because I think there's been different suggestions, right? But I don't mm. think it'll ever happen in the U.S. all the way from the top, like you said, with MLS, right? Because there's just... It's an investment, mm-hmm. right? Sizable investment for those ownership groups, right? At MLS, and they're not going to take that risk of being relegated, right?
They just no, won't. I don't think so. It has to start it from the bottom up. I think starting from lower leagues may be the solution. Maybe mm-hmm. down the road, when things are a little bit more sustainable, yeah. then we can implement using MLS or not. Mm-hmm. They might choose just to be out.
Okay.
I think, you know, it's hard, because the biggest part of your operational cost is going to be travel. So if you open up, you know, a fourth tier team to yeah. play a second tier team, and then you have to travel across the country, that yeah. might be 30% of your yearly budget
yeah.
with the cost of flying yeah. Yeah. and going yeah. over there.
That's one of the things they say, is because U.S. is such a big country, right?
Right.
You're not going to be able to, you know, go all the way yeah. from coast to coast, right? That's why yeah. they do this regional model, right, for the right. lower divisions.
And that's I think that's where they should continue going.
Okay.
But also, you know, we do a lot of bad things in Brazil. I guess mm-hmm. we're not...
like what?
You know, Brazil as a country is a little bit disorganized. You okay. know, you see in the Olympics what happened, the legacy that we left. It wasn't the most responsible usage of money. Mm-hmm. Let's put it that way. Okay. But I think one thing that Brazilians do very well, they tend to help each other behind the mm-hmm. scenes. Like the clubs are really, you know, as much as people criticize the National Federation,
yeah.
the National Federation fund a lot of the travel mm-hmm. That allows these minor league teams, or this second tier, third tier, fourth tier teams, to keep a sustainable operational model. So let's say if U.S. soccer perhaps one day look at that and say, huh, I'm making XYZ money in TV rights, right? Mm-hmm. Let me take a side of this, and let me spend some of this in investing in operational costs mm-hmm. that are going to help these teams to be sustainable.
Right.
So they don't have to be keep closing doors every week or every year. Mm-hmm. And then it's every year there's 10 teams that close doors and another 20 that open.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not a sustainable long-term
yeah.
plan. And
it's not good for the fans especially, right?
No, not at all. I mean, you don't pop up a team and, yeah. and have 300 people or 1,000 people coming in your stands. You know, it takes some time. And you need that long-term strategy. So I think it needs to come from U.S. soccer too. They need to reinvest some of the money that they're making into these lower division teams, perhaps maybe assisting them with operational costs. That'll be the, mm-hmm. the start. You know, that's what the Brazilian Federation does.
You're kind of do you consider yourself in a tough market or a good market? Because you're in San Bernardino, which mm-hmm. is, you know, Inland Empire, and it's not like the heart of L.A. area, right? It's on the outskirts and... Mm-hmm. You know, you have a lot of professional teams out here mm-hmm. on various levels. Now there's LAFC on top of LA Galaxy. There's other USL teams, right? Do you feel that that's good or bad for you in your market, you know?
Well, the way I look at things, it's anything I do in life and okay. answering your question, it's the half empty cup, half full cup okay. analysis, you know? Obviously, you can look at ways of saying that's a bad thing, okay. you know, to be in San Bernardino. You know, okay. it's the lowest, one of the lowest income per capita in the country, and or in California. It's not typical California city. Mm-hmm. It's not the demographics perhaps that have the money to sustain your football team. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you know, if you flip things around and you look at them and say, those are the most passionate. Those are 60% Hispanics that really consume soccer. They are the true hardcore fans. There's a tremendous amount of quality players coming out of San Bernardino, the Island Empire, and playing professionally elsewhere.
How is that? Are they like, is there a sizable like Hispanic community there? Is that why? And these guys are just, they love and they're passionate about soccer.
Exactly. It's over 60%, I think.
So before you were there, then what were these guys doing? Like, you know, just basically high school and that's it?
That's a good question. And nobody was looking at them. You know, it was a region that was neglected, you know, even by the top teams that you just mentioned. I mean, LAFC just started, but Chivas USA, I think they, when they were around, they're looking at doing some things in San Bernardino. Galaxy, I don't know why, what their business model and strategy is, but they are in other markets, but not necessarily in the Island Empire. So that area
was traditionally being overlooked, you're saying?
Yeah, it's being overlooked. I mean, it's tough to have a team there, because even if you perhaps have bigger aspirations to play bigger leagues, a lot of things that are going to help you pay your bills, it's going to be TV market. Okay. So TV rights. And then San Bernardino doesn't have their local TV channels. I mean, we tap into this LA channel.
Right.
And you're absolutely right. We're competing with two baseball teams, two American football teams now. And then you have two basketball teams, you have two hockey teams. Yeah. It's too much.
Right.
You know, nobody's going to really pay attention. And I think that's the biggest struggle that, for instance, USL team out of Orange County faces with. You know, they rarely get any TV exposure because you're competing with all these different sports. Right. And there's so much sports that you can show on TV.
You know what it is? Okay, so I've been to the USL games. I've been to when they were OC Blues. I went there. I think the problem with these teams is, right, is you can't compete with the top division teams like MLS, right? Because it's a different game, right? And like you said, they're not going to tune in to your games when there's, you know, multiple professional teams, right? So you have to really embrace the local community, I think, right? And at the same time, it's about like, it's about fan experience, right? Like, it's not about necessarily the game, right? It is the game too, and it has to be there. And if you guys are terrible on the field, that's one thing. But you, a lot of times, even though like you might not be successful on the field, you can make up for that with like a great fan experience, right? Mm-hmm. Where, you know, you just have like a family of like four is coming to a game in San Bernardino, and they're gonna go watch SoCal SC, and they just have a great time. Like, you know, like there aren't too many other options out there in terms of like to actually go to a professional game. Right. And I think that's something that these, you know, lower division teams, maybe some of them are not, you know, capitalizing on properly.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. I think there's a lot of things that baseball is looking at us now because they see soccer kind of taking a little bit away of baseball.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think that there's things that we should look at baseball. Mm-hmm. I think minor league baseball 20, 30 years ago, it's exactly where minor league soccer is right now. Mm-hmm. And minor league baseball has been extremely successful because they have established themselves on these markets, smaller markets, where there's nothing there. Right. And then you're not selling sports, you're selling entertainment.
Sure.
You know, so it's a taking a family of four and eat hot dogs and paying $2-3 for tickets. It's a cheap entertainment. It might be the only thing they're going to do in terms of
entertainment. Right? Yeah,
in terms of entertainment. Yeah. So you're absolutely right. The lower division teams are definitely missing a little bit of that. You need to know who you are. You know, that's for us. Like, we know that we're never going to be a first division team. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's LA teams. They're much stronger, much better communities. We are a feeder team. Mm-hmm. We are a development team. We are always going to be that development. Mm-hmm. You know, that's strategically where we position ourselves. Once you understand who you are, you're going to promote yourself accordingly.
Okay.
You know, and then you're going to make strategies, you're going to make partnerships where you can provide a path for these players to showcase their skills there and then eventually go to these other leagues that you have partnerships with or you have connections with. And the same thing applies for the fans.
Okay. So let me say this. So like you're in a smaller market, you're not at, you know, Division One, so you're not expecting like 24,000 people to show up as a goal, right? Mm-hmm. What is ideal for you? Like, you know what I mean? Like in 5 years' time, if you're hitting all cylinders, what kind of like scenario and situation and number of fans are you looking at?
I mean, if last year I think we averaged probably about 250 people, you know? That doesn't even scratch the surface to pay the bill and the cost to actually play that game,
right?
You know? I would say if we can get it to 1,000, mm-hmm. you know, in 2 years, and then 3-5 years from now, we can get to 2-3,000 people watching our games. I think we can say that we did very well, because mm-hmm. teams at USL, you know, there are teams at USL not doing that.
Right.
So, yes, San Bernardino, it's a smaller market, mm-hmm. you know, but it's still the Island Empire. It's still a couple million people there. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot of people there. Right. But again, what are they consuming in terms of minor sports? We're the only. You know, there's one team that played in NPSL with us that it's based out of Riverside. Mm-hmm. It's either us or them in terms of soccer there.
Right.
Are these people traveling all the way there to go see the Galaxy? Are they going to travel all the way there to go see LAFC?
Every once in a while, right? Not like an every other weekend type of thing, right?
And then, you know, growing up, you brought up about Brazil. I grew up in Brazil. And now this is one thing that I think people is totally missing about, like, it's very cool to support Arsenal and buy Barcelona jerseys and have Manchester City memorabilia in your house.
Okay.
But for me, what the best memories mm-hmm. was actually to go and watch fourth division soccer with my dad.
Okay.
You know, that was my to go weekend. You know, that was the building memories.
Okay.
I think.
But when so you were supporting your local team, right? Mm-hmm. Where you grew up.
Yeah,
I had fourth division, right?
Yeah, I support Gremio, which is my team in Brazil, but also in my city, there's a team called Esportivo.
Okay.
And Esportivo never play anything more than, you know, my state first division. I think the maximum that they got maybe it was Brazilian fourth division.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah, but what's the number of fans that are showing up to this game?
3,000, 5,000.
See what I'm saying? It's still because, like, there's an atmosphere to it, right?
Yeah, of course.
Like, it's still, you know, people are like enjoying food, music, and they're mm-hmm. having a good time, right?
Exactly. Yeah. But I think everything starts, and I tell our players, mm-hmm. you know, you don't build this atmosphere out of nowhere. Start from the players, start from the families of the ones that are directly involved. And then you have a friend, you have a cousin, you have a girlfriend, you have somebody else. And then with time, you build this atmosphere. Mm-hmm. It's not a fake. It's actually organically, it has to be organically built. You know, you start inviting friends, hey, listen, come support me. It's not the best soccer. You're not selling soccer. You're selling this entertainment. Mm-hmm. Let's hang out. Let's spend time together. Support what I love. You know, I love playing soccer. I play for SoCal because I love soccer. I don't play for money because there's no money at this level. You know, come support me what I love. You know, I have an ultimate goal of eventually becoming a professional player. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm better than this, but this is all it is. Mm-hmm. So let me try here. Right. Come support me because you support me ultimately, you know, an overall life goal.
Okay.
So I think that's atmosphere needs to be built.
Right. So you're a former player, right? You played in Brazil?
Yeah, I played in Brazil, but never made it professional. I played for Gremio, mm-hmm. all the youth level. Mm-hmm. Then I went to Argentina. I played for Ferro and River Plate. Mm-hmm. And I got a scholarship to come over to the U.S., play college soccer in San Diego. So I never really went professional.
What do you think is the main difference in terms of, I guess, like Brazilian players versus like American players, since you have experience on both, you know? Because everyone kind of uses the Brazilian style as like the template for success, kind of, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think is the difference between U.S. style of play and Brazilian style of play that why can't like U.S. be, you know, more successful or, you know what I mean, on the international stage?
I think both styles have positives and negatives. Mm-hmm. You know, Brazilian obviously have more flair mm-hmm. and has more ability to create decisions that's going to really make a difference in a game.
Yeah.
You know, in a perfect world, I would love the Brazilian players to have the American discipline. Mm-hmm. You know, I think U.S.
Well, Brazilian players party too much, huh?
It's hard, but I mean, if you put it this way, John, a lot of players in Brazil come from very
poor
background. You know, so one day you have nothing, the other day you wake up and you're a millionaire.
Okay,
you know, you're not
that discipline necessarily.
You're not really life prepared for that change. Okay. You know, you have all this amount of money, and what do you do with it?
Right.
So it's, I don't know if I would be able mm-hmm. to be disciplined. You know, I was educated. You know, but it's still. Would I be able to deal with that? Mm-hmm. Deal with fame? It's not that easy too, mm-hmm. you know? So I'm not defending them. Yeah. I think everything has a limit. You have to find a balance in life. When is too much? Mm-hmm. You know, too little and too much of everything is never good. You have to find that balance. So you say about American style, what is the American style? I mean, there is no American style.
So this is what I think about American style, right? I think American style of soccer, especially, they... coaches and teams, and even at the youth levels, they reward, and this is what I see and this is what I hear a lot of times when I ask players, they reward like the physicality of the sport, right? The athleticism. So like less emphasis, maybe not less emphasis on skill, but they emphasize like the speed and the power and, you know what I mean, and running and that kind of thing more than like technical ability, I think.
Well, I think they do that because they, that's the only, you're always going to focus and highlight your advantage. They're much more physical. The technical ability is not there yet. But again, what happens is we have to look back at the player development model that's being used in this country.
Yeah.
You have a lot of kids playing soccer from 6 to 12.
Right.
And then when it comes to that crucial development stage, which is from 12 to 18, the players are playing something else because the money is elsewhere. You know, there's a better scholarship at golf. There might be a better scholarship at baseball, American football, basketball. And then the players are coming back to play soccer at 18. Yeah. And they say, oh, I'm a sport guy. You know, I you know, play soccer when I was little. And then the last 6 years I've been playing American football. Now I didn't cut it. Let me just go play soccer because I know how to run fast. And at a college level, I can run faster than the others.
Right.
And I'm going to get a better scholarship. You know, but is that a better soccer player? You know, is this a guy that's going to be a top 100 player in the world in soccer for the United States?
Yeah.
You have 300 million people in this country. You have to be able to produce a soccer player. And with all the respect of the so many good players out there that play for U.S. soccer, it hasn't been one that can be considered that top player worldwide.
Do you think the lower division soccer in America has like a bright future in terms of maybe, like, for example, I want to use the example of like women's soccer, right? NWSL, they just recently signed like a 3-year deal with you know, Arts A&E, right? And so they have a TV deal now and they're part of the ownership, and so there's a lot more like visibility, right? Do you think lower division soccer in the US, all the way, you know, like even with USL and NASL and NPSL, do you think there's that type of opportunity in the future?
I think so. I think if you get all these ownership groups, and listen, rivalry in soccer, it's essential, right? But that's for the fans. You know, fans need to know that club A hates B and B hates A. Behind the scenes, clubs together are much more powerful. So if all these minor league clubs can get together and stop independently, selfishly think about themselves, try to come together where they can negotiate proper TV rights that make benefit every single one of them equally, I think ultimately there is a bigger opportunity. There are clubs that are better and bigger than the others, you know, but it's been proven that, I mean, how much do you like watching Spanish league? Because, you know, Spanish league, it's either A or B that's going to win with rare exceptions. I love watching Brazilian league because at the beginning of the league, there's 20 teams that play in the first division. All the 20 have a chance to win. You know, you have to have that competition, you know. There are always going to be teams with more fans and more money and more so and so than the others. But when it comes to TV rights, when it comes to all these other things, it has to be equally distributed, perhaps. You know, that's what I believe. So behind the scenes, I think the clubs need to start working more together. And that's not what happened at the youth, happening at the minor league levels right now.
Right. Youth soccer is probably, in America, is probably broken right now, right?
I mean, there's teams making money, but the pay-to-play model, I think, which it's what's broken. You know, I think more and more you're going to see the people coming here and really looking at it as a serious opportunity to play professionally and going abroad and not coming here because the opportunity is not being given to them here properly.
What do you think about LAFC and, you know, they're going to start next year, right? And within the LA market, right, they're going to be competing against LA Galaxy, right? I think competition is good. What do you think is going to be happening next year with the soccer? Is going to raise all the profile for everybody and kind of, and, you know, have renewed interest for clubs like yourself? What do you think? What's going to happen?
I think so. It takes a little bit attention, obviously, you know, in the media size. But honestly, like I say to you, we have to know who we are. We're not competing with them. I think we have to find ways of working with them and say, rather than just looking for players randomly, maybe look at this platform that we're trying to put it together for you, where maybe your next average player is already there. You know, you don't have to look for them. I think LAFC is great coming into the market. I think LA is big enough that it can sustain two soccer teams. What I like about what they're doing is they're really trying to make this community approach where they understanding that they have to embrace all these different cultures. You know, LA is not about Hispanics or about whites or about this and that. It's about this melting pot. Yeah. You have a little bit of everything. You know, you have huge communities of all different kinds. Mm. And hopefully they can continue in that line and that can convert into fans into the seats.
All right. You know, what's helped me kind of get more interested in like fourth division teams and NPSL is when I start reading and hearing about and watching like these teams competing in the U.S. Open Cup, right? And they start doing well. And teams like La Máquina or LA Wolves, and they start kind of going deep in the U.S. Open Cup. Mm-hmm. And they actually have the ability to play against like, you know, Division II and Division I teams. Mm-hmm. It makes me like look more into those clubs and kind of follow the local players, right? How are you guys in the U.S. Open Cup? You know, is that something that is a emphasis for you guys?
Yeah, I think so. We haven't qualified. Mm-hmm. I think we're just a few spots shy of qualifying last year.
Mm-hmm. Is it just how many teams from NPSL would qualify? I think, like the top in your conference?
Yeah, I think it was just the top. I think it was just Albion ending up qualifying from our conference. Listen, I think it's a tough thing. I love the concept, you know, but I really hope the top teams don't try to kill it. Because that means that once La Máquina or LA Wolves or anybody else that it's competing against them, it's showing cases their weaknesses.
Okay.
You know, so playing these top teams that we know, you know, because we are in the world of soccer, we know they're
higher level, right?
Supposedly, right? But when you're playing them and you're making them suffer, you're making them look bad, there's two options. Mm-hmm. That incentivates you to get better, or you decided to let's not play these guys anymore.
Okay,
you know, so there's all these rumors of top teams. Maybe MLS is going to not play US Cup anymore.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So hopefully that is not really the route that they chose to go. Because listen, if you are a better team, then go there and kill them 4-0, 5-0. You know, do what you should do because you're a much richer, you're a much bigger team. You know,
I think everybody enjoys that underdog story, though. Everybody likes the David and Goliath, right? Nobody's rooting for Goliath.
Exactly. Look at FA Cup. You know, all these beautiful stories. Exactly. Why can we not do here in America?
Right.
You know, so hopefully the U.S. Soccer and the guys for MLS and you know the topper the bigger leagues. Mm-hmm. Can look at a U.S. Cup as a great tool, you know, a great opportunity for us to see these underdogs, you know, coming and doing their Cinderella stories.
Sure.
And hopefully that doesn't change. But that means, I think, you know, right now it's a qualifier, right? Yeah. You have a certain number of teams per league. I think they got to find a way of giving more, you know, have more teams for the minor leagues participating because it's all about putting the message out, you know, and there's bigger teams. I mean, there's more open opportunity there, the more teams are going to participate, the more it's going to motivate them to do better, and competition is great for the game.
I've seen other NPSL teams like in their preseason, right, play against higher division teams. I think like Chattanooga FC was playing against
Atlanta United.
Exactly, right. Atlanta United, right? Is that something that you guys are pursuing as well? Because I think that would really drum up interest, right? And I think it'd be awesome. Like if you guys played against even like, let's say, LAFC's second team, right? Or LA Galaxy's second team, you know, for a preseason, right? Dude, I would love to go watch that, right?
Yeah. No, I think you're right. It's just like a minor... I'm putting myself in the minor league shoes, right? Okay. Which is where we are right now.
Yeah.
I think we have nothing to lose to play those games.
Sure.
Right? Yeah. We're supposed to lose that game already.
Right.
But then putting myself in the other team's shoes, they're a much higher team and much bigger team. What are they getting out of that?
Right.
You know, it's like if I lose to these guys, it's going to make me look really bad. Yeah. And it's the beginning of the season. If I beat these guys, I did nothing that I should have done it. Mm. You know, like I should have won that game.
Right.
So why am I going to risk myself on putting myself in that situation?
Well, why do you think Atlanta United was willing to play Chattanooga FC?
I think because Atlanta United was, it's a new franchise.
Okay.
And then that's a good market for them to capitalize fans outside of Atlanta.
Get additional fans for that.
Exactly.
Okay.
You know, we try to play other teams, you know, we try to play USL teams here. Okay. We had a friendly scrimmage match with the trialist of Orange County Soccer Club.
Okay.
So we're right at the beginning of the season. And hopefully down the road, these teams can see, like, mm-hmm. we're good enough that provide good competition for them.
Yeah.
And we also want to test our players against top teams, you know, playing. We always play in the same teams in the NPSL. We always want to be creative a little bit and try to, you know, showcase them in front of a better team just mm-hmm. to see if you're really good or if you're really struggling.
Right, right. Any big announcements coming up with the club or something special that fans can look forward to?
Just that we are in the right direction, I think. Yeah. Our business plan, it's a long-term business model. Mm-hmm. I think from year one, we are a little bit above than our expectations were. Mm-hmm. Big announcements. Hopefully we can eventually play our games at San Bernardino Soccer Complex when mm-hmm. our arena concept there stays. Right now, we appreciate the opportunity that's been given to us to play at the Fairplex. Mm-hmm. So we're going to play our games in Pomona. I think, you know, we're going to see some good players coming out of the SoCal squad right now. And in the paper, it looks really good. You know, let's see how that converts as the season develops. Mm-hmm. And then if next year we make it to the U.S. Open Cup, I won't be surprised that much. And hopefully mm-hmm. we can make something interesting out of that, make an impact.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Yeah. Are there any kind of future rivalries? Are you guys, is like the Riverside or are they Coras?
Coras, yeah.
Yeah, are they your main rival right now, or are you anticipating
geographically? Yeah. Yes, geographically they are. You know, they kind of beat us last year twice, mm-hmm. so we have no bragging rights mm-hmm. above and beyond them.
Yeah.
Hopefully we can change that this year.
Okay.
So
speaking of which, right? You're talking about so you guys do a home and away, right? Mm-hmm. And then you guys lost to them at home, right?
3-2.
3-2. I haven't seen the documentary, but I heard about it where there was a documentary that you guys covered on your team and you went crazy and went off on the players, right? Yeah. After that home loss, right?
Yeah.
So like for those people that haven't been able to watch that documentary yet, like what was that about? Why was that so controversial? You were screaming at these guys, and was it like not safe for work language involved? What happened with that?
I know. But yeah. I mean, that's, I guess it's Daniel as it comes to the world, you know, it's me and my peer passionate, you know, I'm a passionate guy, you know, and maybe this is why I am who I am. Mm-hmm. I think I told the producer, I told Jared at the time, I don't think he does a good job putting me in a good spot, but there was really good reasons for us to be that way. I think the weekend before, we played one of the top teams in the league, and we lost to them, even though we have dominated the game completely. Mm-hmm. You know, so we weren't upset because we saw that our players try their best. Mm-hmm. And then we play Coras the following weekend. You know, not that the Coras was a worse team, but they came with only 11 players, maybe 12. Maybe they had one sub. Mm-hmm. It was a 2:00 game in the afternoon. A lot of our players show up to the game late. Mm-hmm. You know, they're walking into the field as we already warming up.
Right.
So I was already upset with the lack of respect and a little bit disappointed with the commitment. You know, I mean.
So if the game start time was for 2:00.
Yeah.
And you guys were warming up at like what time?
1:30, and players were walking.
People were walking onto the field at that time.
But our players, you know. Yeah. So it was like, show a little bit of respect to your teammates, show a little bit of respect to your coaches.
When are they supposed to be there by then?
It's usually 2 hours before.
2 hours before, okay. Mm-hmm. So they're really late then, right?
They're really late, yeah. But that's not really necessarily like the only reason, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Like I say, it was a very hot day.
Okay.
The other team doesn't have any subs. The other team got 2 red cards. Mm. And we still managed to lose the game 3-2.
So you guys lost the game 3-2, but you guys were up. And they had only 9 players at the end of the game?
Yeah.
Okay, right. So then you went off on your players and
demanded,
professionalism.
Exactly. Kind of thing. I mean, listen, it's not because you're in the fourth division and you think you are this big dog, right? That everybody thinks that they shouldn't be there. Mm. Everybody thinks
like this is just a stepping stone, right?
Yeah,
every guy thinks that, right?
Yeah, every soccer player thinks like, I'm much better than this.
Well, I'm much better than everyone else too,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Okay.
But if you're there, mm-hmm. there's maybe a reason why you're there, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
Maybe you did something in your life that mm-hmm. now you're here. And if you're better than anybody that's here, mm-hmm. then demonstrate that on the field.
Prove it then, right?
Prove it. Just go there and score 5 goals. Kill it. Be the man of the match.
Yeah.
Listen, if you do a great job, somebody's going to notice that mm-hmm. and going to take you to where you belong. right? If you don't think you belong there,
yeah,
somebody's going to notice that.
Okay.
Showing up late, showing disrespect,
yeah, yeah,
playing like you don't care, that's not going to take you anywhere. If going to take you, it's going to take you to a lower level.
Right.
So it was a combination of factors, you know, and we felt like they needed a wake-up call. Mm-hmm. Everybody can judge me and say you were right, you're wrong, and say it's one of the most controversial parts of the movie, mm-hmm, or of the documentary. Talk to my wife about this, mm-hmm, a lot of times, why you want to showcase that. Mm-hmm. And it's like, here, I am who I am.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not going to...
It makes me really want to watch the documentary now.
Yeah, I hope you watch it.
I'm going to now. I want to see that scene. Where does that scene come up? Like, what minute mark?
It's about 30. It's
30
about,
minutes?
Yeah, I think all it's right, halfway. I'm
fast forward and go specifically to that scene.
Yeah.
But basically, it kind of triggered the team and kind of helped them turn the season around a little
bit,
right?
The next five games, I think we tied one game and won four.
Okay.
That kind of put us on the track for qualifying in the playoffs. Right. Again, you can judge me if I was wrong. Maybe I shouldn't use that much of full language. Mm-hmm. But
make was it in Portuguese or was it in English?
No, it was in English. Spanish, too.
Spanish, too. Okay. So I've seen you play, right? And you still play, right? You're still in good shape and you still ball out there, right?
I don't know about that.
like me personally, you know, I played, you know, high school, right? And, you know, I was, of course, much better shape then, right? You know, how you know, your coach make you, you know, run 2 hours before you even do practice, right? So I was in much better shape. But I think I'm a better player now, to tell you the truth. I think, like, me playing now, I could beat the younger version of me, the 18-year-old version, right?
Of course. You're more experienced.
Yeah, I'm more experienced. I'm smarter. You know, I just, like, I don't, you know, run as all over the place as much. But, like, I just, you know, I'm more efficient, you know? I do a lot more one-touches, right? Maybe because I'm too tired to, like, hold on to the ball, right? But do you think you're better than your players?
I don't think so.
No?
No.
So you can't hang with those guys? You don't get in during the practice sometimes and play with them?
I do okay, once in a while. But I, you know, physically, I'm not there.
I'm not talking about like a 90-minute game. I'm talking about like on a, you know what I mean? Like even a 5v5 futsal match. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, do you think you're better than them? You can like use your size and, you know what I mean? And
futsal, I think I can. You know, futsal, okay. I have a good, I mean, I grew up playing futsal, so I feel much more comfortable there.
Okay.
But on an 11v11, it's
what about skill wise? They're better than you? All your players are better than you skill wise?
There's some that are really good. Some of them they have nothing.
Okay. So you're liking this, so you can put yourself on the team?
Yeah, I can see myself training.
Really?
I don't know if I can see myself playing.
Okay, because when I was on varsity in my high school, the team, like, you know, when I was a sophomore, our team was really good. Like, we were ranked like fourth in the state. And our coach at the time, he was probably like 30, I think he was still better than all of us.
Yeah,
he played at a high level of college, and he was still like, even though he wasn't as good of a shape, he was still like better.
Yeah, his skills, like, you don't, it's like riding bike.
Yeah.
Once you learn it,
you're
never really going to forget it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have the skills, I still feel like I have the skills, but I don't know, like I say, if I have the fitness.
Mm-hmm.
Soccer is so much faster right now.
Yeah, yeah.
Nowadays, it's really about keeping possession and running.
So you don't jump into the practices?
I do jump, but...
You demonstrate some skills or what?
Yeah, once in a while.
Okay.
Friday's the day before the match. We usually have a little bit of... hang out with the players a little bit more casual. So once in a while, I try to get in there.
Have you seen that one video? I think it's either a South American. I don't think it was Brazil. I think it was like a South American team. It might have been a Mexican team. It's a coach where the coach is doing drills with their players, right? That's volleys. You've seen it?
Yeah.
He's doing volleys, right? And then they're supposed to, is it a pass or a shot from the volley?
It's a shot from the volley.
Shot from the volley, right? Yeah. And then he starts screaming because I guess they were shooting too high. Is that what it was? And he wanted them to do like low.
No, it was it.
Or the passes.
The through ball where he should, I think you're talking about Tuca Tigres.
Okay.
Maybe.
Tell me, okay.
So yeah, it's the yellow and blue.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he wanted the ball to be passed through specifically to a spot.
Mm-hmm.
And these players weren't passing.
They were like, what? It was a shot or it was just bad passes?
The bad passes.
Yeah. They were like chipping it kind of, right?
And he goes there and demonstrates it.
Yeah, and doesn't like, bam, on one time, right? Like, and then once he screamed, like, I'm like 50 years old and I can still do it. Like,
exactly.
I can't understand exactly, but I could tell that's what he was saying, right?
Pretty much.
Like, hey, I'm 50 years old and I can still do this. What is wrong with you, right? That guy has a lot of
passion.
Yeah. Are you like that during your practice sessions?
I think
because you're a pretty intense guy too, right?
Yeah, I think I am. And you know, it makes you have good friends, but also makes you some enemies. And you know, it's not my way or the highway. I just feel like it, if you don't put passion in everything you do, you're not going to be successful, you know. And I am high intense, but I am high intense because how many people out there can say I work on something that I love?
Mm-hmm.
You know, my hobby and my life and my personal life and my work life, it gets all mixed up. Because I never know when I'm working, and I never know when I'm having fun, because I'm having fun when I'm working, and vice versa.
Yeah, so you're very passionate about what you're doing, you're saying, right?
Every day for me is a Friday, you know, every day is a good day, you know, because I'm doing what I love. How many people out there can say that?
Right.
So, you know, whatever it is, you got to find your niche and, and go for it.
So with that passion and with that intensity, right, are your players like intimidated by you? Are they scared of you?
I hope not, but sometimes they could be. Yeah.
Okay. What do they refer to you as? Like, what do they call you? Coach.
Coach. Yeah. Okay. Just coach.
All right.
Which is fine. You know. Listen, I don't. It is kind of like a debate inside of my own house. You know, because I just demand respect. I think you can respect me in so many different ways. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily respect means you have to bow down to me every time you see me. That might not be respect.
Okay.
Respect for me maybe is appreciate everything that we are doing for you. Because if it wasn't us, maybe nobody else was going to be there. What would you be doing now if it wasn't because of this club? Yeah. What would you be doing now if it wasn't because of what we're trying to do here?
Right.
That for me is respect. Appreciate what we're trying to do.
Okay. That's interesting that you say that. I'm curious, what's the typical profile of your players then? Are these guys like just graduated high school kind of and they're not really working, or are they working part-time and they're doing this part-time? What's the kind of the normal average profile for you guys?
It's a little bit of everything. Okay. I have kids that still in high school, still high school and playing for us.
Okay, but so then there's no minimum age for NPSL?
No.
They can be 16, 15 and play?
I believe so. Okay. Yeah, I don't think we have any 15-year-old players. Okay. I know we had some 18s and there was no problem.
Okay.
We had 17 years old last year.
Some are in high school still.
Still in high school.
Playing on their high school team as well or no?
No.
Okay. Because really. They're signing a pro contract with you, right? Mm-hmm. All right. So that high school coach probably doesn't like you then, right?
Not necessarily.
Well, I'm a high school coach and like my top two players are, you know, playing with you guys and not for my team. I'd be like, oh man,
There's so many rules in high school that you cannot play like the development academy. Yeah. You know, there are players that either don't have the grade or
So they might not even be able to play anyways, right? Like they don't have the 2.0 GPA or something,
they're too good for their high school team and they say, listen, why am I going to... You want to be challenged, especially at that age. And one of the things I liked what Klinsmann was trying to do when he was the coach for the U.S. soccer team, he said, hey, listen, our guys are not being challenged enough. Mm-hmm. You know, you got Brazil, they're playing against top teams when they're 16, 17, 18 years old. What are our 17, 18-year players are doing?
Yeah.
Play against each other in the development academy?
Okay.
You know, playing college? Yeah. You know, are they really being challenged to the top level? Mm-hmm. It's great quality. Still, I mean, development academy, I go watch some of the games. It's great quality soccer. Okay. Same thing in college. You see some good quality players. Mm-hmm. But are they being challenged enough? Okay. So this is what the guys are looking for. So I have a little bit of everything. You know, I think our oldest players, it's 26.
Okay.
So we opted to give more opportunity to the younger guys. Mm-hmm. None of our players are, you know, like really on the Sunday league type of guys. Yeah. You know, they're really guys that really think they still have a chance, even though I tell my 25, 26-year-old guys, guys, if you haven't made it past 23, I mean, let's start thinking about something else, you know, because nobody's going to give you a chance, you know, if it hasn't happened, if you haven't got it yet.
Okay. Yeah. So you have like 25, 26-year-old players on your team.
Yeah, but it's only
You're realistic to them though, right?
Obviously.
So then what's the message that you're giving to these guys? You know what I mean? Are you telling them, hey, just, you know, be here and just play for the passion? What's the message you tell to that guy?
No, the message is very clear. It's clear to everybody. You know, it's like, this is a development team.
Okay.
You know, people that are here are looking for an opportunity.
Okay.
They have to self kind of judge themselves and say, listen, am I going to really get an opportunity at 26? Mm-hmm. Some people think they are. Mm-hmm. Reality, you know, at soccer, if you pass 22, 23 and you haven't made it.
Yeah.
It's really tough. It's just like going to the job market, you know. A company is not going to hire a 30-year-old with no experience. Yeah, yeah. They'd much rather hire an 18 with no experience because they can teach them.
So then what are you telling to the 26-year-old? What do you say?
We're not saying anything. They know.
I don't understand. Yeah. So if I'm 26 and I'm like, hey, coach, I want to try out. What do you say? Go ahead. You just don't say anything or what?
No, we tell them.
What do you say though?
They know what the team is for.
This is a development team. So, hey, you're welcome to play on the team.
If you have the skills and you're better than the 23, obviously, we want to give preference to the young
players. Yeah. So playing time and all that. Like, even if a 26-year-old, say, is better than a 22-year-old, you're going to give playing time preference to the 22-year-old.
Exactly.
Okay, so he knows that.
They know that. Okay. They come and clearly know the conditions.
So then the guys are, like, kind of on the bench, even though they might be better?
It could be. Yeah. It could be. And again, there are other teams in the league that might choose a different path.
Right.
Again, yes, we want to win the NPSL.
Yeah.
That's goal. But that's not goal number one. Goal number one is developing players.
Right.
Goal number one is sell ABCD at the end of the season to teams ABCD abroad or here in the US.
Right.
That's what we're doing.
So specifically to your club, the primary goal of your team is to develop players and to that you view them as assets. You're training them and you're providing a platform, and then to sell them to higher level teams.
That's the
primary goal.
I would say that's the sole goal.
Okay. Okay. And other teams, they are maybe trying to win games and sell tickets, and that's their avenue, a revenue model, right?
Which I respect.
Yeah, but you're saying your revenue model is different, right?
Different.
Development.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Got it. Wow, that's interesting. Okay, so wrapping up here, any kind of last words that you want to leave to your fans and encourage kind of guys to, you know, keep up with SoCal Sports Club?
Yeah, I think I appreciate the opportunity, John. Thank you. One message that I want to just give it out, support local soccer, you know? Try to create those memories with your family and provide this opportunity. Help us provide this opportunity to more kids. Help us leave it a legacy that's going to really transform soccer in this country. You know, continue being Arsenal, continue being Barcelona, whatever you want to be fans. You know, they can do okay without your jersey or your ticket that you buy to go watch them in the summer when they come here with their fourth team. You know, there's nobody going to take that legacy away and those memories away of supporting local soccer. You know, that's what I think this is all about.
Awesome, awesome. Okay, thanks again, once again, for tuning in. The Urban Pitch Podcast, here's the game of life.